welcome to family and friends who've gathered here with us today evening. I know that for most of you, this is the first big gathering that you're going to after several months. Thank you for coming, and thanks to so many of you for really standing by us through what's been a very difficult 2020 and what's proving to be a quite a challenging 2021 as well. I know it's very difficult and strange also celebrating my father's birthday without him being here.
Especially somebody who is generally enthusiastic about all birthdays. At the same time, I don't think I can associate my father with anything besides happiness and celebration. And I've said this several times over, actually. And when I think about celebration, automatically I think about food and music, two things my father was extremely passionate about. In June last year, soon after the lockdown lifted, we managed to have on the occasion of Guru Purnima, a very small gathering at home, where our neighbour and my father's student, Sharmishtha, did a lovely session with pre-recorded songs on piano, and they were of course largely spiritual songs. It was a very moving event, but it was also a somber affair. At the end of it, my friend Rukmini Chakraborty, who unfortunately couldn't be here today, decided to break into something very impromptu, but it was delightful. It was an Indonesian boatman song. Her area of study is Southeast Asia, so that's one of the things that she was also reading up on, in fact, and she's a good performer. And somewhere I bring Rukmini here because I thank her for giving me the idea about today evening's program, really. Because when I think of it, my father's love for music was very secular and it was so eclectic. So when Monidipa and Rohan, they were asking me for ideas about what to perform, I said, you can actually keep it as open as possible, because even a few months back when I was going through his cassette collection at home, what did I find there? There was everything from Kishori Amonkar to Harry Belafonte to S.D. Burman to A.R. Rahman to Latin choral music to things that he had recorded when he was in Cambridge. They were like old radio request shows. So it was a kind of crazy range, and it all of course brought back a ton of memories and emotions. When I think of my father and my earliest association of my father in music, it was possibly putting me to sleep with Nana Muskuri playing in the background. Much later, when I was in school, I was almost finishing school giving my board exams, the two of us had this kind of ritual of playing the Beatles, the greatest hits album. There was a number one on the cover, many of you might remember. And it was a kind of exercise in calming down, both as a harrowed parent and as a harrowed student. And it was just lovely, in fact. And he always knew what song to play for me on what day. And then, of course, I left Calcutta, went off to JNU, then came back to work in the city. By then, my paternal grandmother, this is my thamma, had come to stay with us. And a lot of the discussion then actually moved to Malayali film music and songs, and choral music even over there. And my grandmother, unfortunately, after her cataract operation, couldn't really read much, but she was hooked onto those Asianet serials. I used to joke about it a lot. But, you know, I ended up even picking up a bit of the language again, thanks to those. And so one thing, of course, was Malayali film music, but then there was also her love for Carnatic classical, because she had had an early training in it, but of course she couldn't ever pursue a career in that music. So there was that, and then finally it was good old Hollywood musicals, Oklahoma, Sound of Music. When Christopher Plummer passed away, I think he took away with him, like, of course, a lot of our childhoods, really. So yeah, so that was, I think, the discussion around all that took over. Even one thing, of course, I forgot to mention was that in college we had a special course called Literature and the Other Arts, where for the first time I think we also engaged with music in a slightly intellectual way. And my father was seriously enthusiastic about this one paper I wrote, which was on the role of Simon and Garfunkel's music in The Graduate. And even as I was researching it, I think he was busy telling me what you should go to the American Center to look up this particular book, that, etc. So, you know, he was always there, really. And in some sense, I'm much more of a purist, and I go back to the same set of songs that I grew up with. But my father was always open to, you know, all kinds of music. It's taken me a while to really get there, and part of it, I could say, was really his influence. When I say this business of being open to everything, I think honestly that's what allowed him to even adjust to Calcutta and Bengali culture so well. Because next thing I know, you know, he was of course attending Dover Lane Music Conference with my mother, and when I went back there with my friend Rudrani while I was in college, he was telling us about his time visiting the place. And then there was during Durga Puja, Mohalaya part, he would always religiously wake up with us and listen to it. There were times he also discussed Jibon Mukhi Gan, like, you know, Shumon and Anjun Dotto, although I told him, well, I'm a fan and not a fan of Anjun Dotto. There's no escaping Rovindra Sangeet, of course, and the Guha Thakurtas, every time we had a family gathering, there was always music involved. And my father very patiently also sat through those and, you know, learned to appreciate the music. So this aspect of really, in some sense, adjusting so easily, being always open to things and really being at home in the world is best encapsulated by a song which was really close to my father's heart, which is Ami and Jajavar by Bhupen Hazarika. And hopefully we will have some Bhupen today evening. I'm not sure whether we'll exactly have Jajavar, but Moni Deepa has promised to perform a Bhupen song. This is really it from my end. I would ask you to keep in mind that image of my father as a Jajavar, really. And in some sense, today's musical journey will be eclectic, but I hope, you know, you all enjoy it, and somewhere or the other, everything connects. With us today, there's going to be Moni Deepa, Toishi and Shantun. They are outside, they'll be coming in a bit. And then there's going to be Rohan / Hasar taking over after that. The first 40 minutes are going to be devoted to folk music. We'll have a short break after that. My mama might pitch in with the harmonica. There's Ranjan uncle who wants to perform a bit. And then there's going to be Rohan taking over towards the end. I definitely urge all of you to hum and sing along, because some of these are very familiar songs. All of you have grown up with them as well. Last weekend I was at a Shahana Bajpai gig, and I think one of the best parts of that gig was the fact that everybody sang along with her, and she wanted it that way. So today evening really has to be about collective music making and memory making, I'd say. With that, I think I'm going to close my bit over here. I'll again come in to introduce singers. One thing I will also say is that we've got a little gift that Ma and I have been putting together over the last many months. And this is something, in fact, of course, also for all of you, which is a website devoted to my father. And it brings together a lot of his public writings, academic writings, personal and professional photos. Some of these you've already seen in the PPT. Videos of lectures that he gave, some of the films that he worked on, and tributes that have really been pouring in over the last many months. This is a small step. We hope to be able to expand that into something more, something that could really be of use to a lot of students who are specialists in European and Russian history also. With that, I ask Ma to come and take over.
I don't think I can say anything. I have stood at this podium and introduced so many things ever since this institution came into being. I never imagined I would have to do this. As I speak, I can almost see him coming and sitting at the back. He normally would. Whatever events were held, Hari would be here. As much for the event, but also because one of those things that was happening in which I was involved, and he knew how important. He used to say Jadunath Bhavan was like a late child in my life. I have grandchildren at home, four-footed,
So this was some kind of dead child which I had to bring up. So, and in fact, we are opening here on after one full year. So this place has been shut, like most public places have. Our last event here was in end of February. But I know one event that Hari was, this was at the end of January. There was a memorial lecture given by Deepesh Chakraborty, and Hari was there. And I just, and normally he would come late. He, punctuality was never our strong point, neither of us. But he would always sit quietly at the back. So that's the image I like to think, that he's somewhere here. It's very hard because I was telling somebody, I certainly grew up with Hari. I was 23 when I met him. So it's been 40 years. He was, and if I count the 2 years when I was a student at Calcutta University, then that's 42 years. But I only think of him as the greatest gift in life, simply because families are what you inherit, parents, siblings. Friends are those you seek out and they happen. And a life partner comes in many ways. I always thought of Hari Mo as one of my closest friends, and we remain that way. So I suddenly realized that I cannot think of him as dying. I can only think of him as one day doing a disappearing act, because that's the way it happened. We were leading, in fact, a strangely enjoyable time in the month of April. Enjoyable because everybody was under lockdown, and our daughter was with us, and the three of us were together and at home all the time. Something that never happens. I can't remember when it last happened. Because when Vrinalini comes, she's out from 12 in the afternoon till 2 at night. And she normally would come for 5 days, and she had 25 people to meet. So having Vrinalini with us for a full 5 to 6 weeks, and at that point, who would think that 1 year later she would still be here? None of us thought. And to have Hari and me home all the time, because, you know, we are busy people too, and Hari after retirement, I don't think, was sat down even for a month. He was super active, doing different things. So when I retired in September 2019, I said, maybe I'll be a lady of leisure, something I've never been, and be supported by a husband who, post-retirement, is still doing many things. And he said, yes, why don't you take that seriously and take it easy? But that was never meant to be, because my retirement coincided with my mother-in-law falling and turning very crucially ill. So Amma's fall and becoming bedridden happened in September. And it was a painful end for her. But I have to say, if Hari was an incredible father, husband, teacher, friend, colleague, he was certainly the kind of son that I've never seen. I mean, my brothers are all very devoted to my parents too. But the kind of care that Hari gave his mother, particularly because his father died some time ago, the way he cared for his mother was truly exceptional. He would sit and record her songs, he would sit and record her stories. And many of you may know that he has written his mother's memoirs. It's called Memories of a Malabar Lady. And the book is going to be out very soon. So when Hari in April was looking at the proofs of the book, and he said, I'm going to bring it out in my mother's and my name, because my mother spoke it and I wrote it. And by writing it, of course, he had done a lot of background research. So it went to that level of not just care, but companionship. And I think that's what Hari was remarkable at. He was able to give people time. And somebody told me he made each and every person feel important, whether a young student or whether an elderly man, Hari was able to give. He was one of the best listeners, something we don't do very much ourselves. And he gave people time. But the time he gave his mother and saw her through to the end was truly amazing. And then she passed away in the middle of January. Her end came as a relief. She was suffering a lot. But while she lay in bed, she would sing. The only thing she would do towards the end was sing. And one of the songs she would sing is a song we'll be hearing today. It's Cat Stevens, Morning Has Broken. And then Hari told me, it's a very personal thing, but I thought I should share. Hari kept saying, now all these years I've given my mother, now I'm going to give all my time to the other two women in my life. I said, about time, Hari. And he kept saying that. The day he left for hospital and Rinalini took him, he told me, he had a sense by then that he had COVID, because I look at his phone messages, he's writing to Shulanjan, he's writing to Bhakuda, saying, I think I have COVID, I need a hospital bed, can you help? Bapu's already helping, looking. It breaks my heart to read those messages, but up to the fourth, he was texting people about his condition. So maybe he had a sense of things going wrong that last Sunday. And he told me the same thing again. I wanted to give all my time to both of you. I said, you're going to. And of course, that was not meant to be. But what Hari has given me in his absence is strength. I never thought I would have the strength to carry on a normal life. And of course, Hari gave me the best gift of all, which is my daughter, who's been a pillar to me, really, because in a way, her loss is much greater. I had him for 40 years. Rinalini just celebrated her 31st birthday, and there's a lot Hari would have had to give her. Hari was to mentor her, to take her through life. But she has taken it stoically, with amazing strength. And I feel, again, that's a gift that Hari has left me with. I'll not be personal anymore. I'll just like to say the person we have to thank for the website is actually Boranjoy Guhathakutta. He first planted the idea because, as you know, as a freelance journalist, a lot of his writings are up. He has a very active website. So sometime in June or July, he said, let's start a website for Hari, very early on. And it's Dada's web designer who took us through the entire technical process. I generated most of the content for it. So it was, he bought the web domain. He put us in touch with Shubir Ghosh, who took us through it. So in a way, the origins came with him. But after that, we realized how much time it would take to really put things together. So Mrinalini may be better in taking you through this. So as we, Hari was a kind of person who, now let me just mouse touch here, okay. So those Vedanya. Let me say that this term was used by Shohik in the resolution of respect of Calcutta University. Later, Madhubi, hold on to the thing. Madhubi Bhattacharya of Gorki Shadan, who is a Russian specialist too, I said, because there were two words that Shobhik used, those Vidanya and those Avatra. So I said, what do they, one means till tomorrow, so I know there is no tomorrow here. But he said, actually in Russian, the word for goodbye is till we meet again. So those Vidanya actually means till we meet again, but Russia, in Russian, use it to say goodbye. So it's in that spirit that we used it. If you scroll down the home page, I'll just quickly take you through. So there were tributes. Instead of tributes, we used extracts from Hari's writings. One during one of his Russian revolution centenary writings, and one which is the very last piece he wrote for NewsClick, which is on migrant labor, food shortage and hunger. Okay, then the photograph here is important. It's from the Afanasi Nikitin expedition that Hari was crazy enough to go on. This was the spirit of adventure in his life. I also love it because he's looking like 100% genuine Russian here. It was an expedition that took them from Tver, from which Afanasi Nikitin came. And actually, Hari's PhD thesis was on the Zemstvo and Tver. But in those days in Russia, you only got visas for a city at a time. So Hari could never visit Tver when he actually was doing his PhD, even though it's hardly outside Moscow. And most of his research was actually done in Finland, where the Imperial Archives were. So Tver is where, and Nikitin remains this big obsession in his life. His book, In the Footsteps of Nikitin, came out of this. But in 2006 and 7, with a group, we'll be showing the film later, and the film is part of the website. They actually went on this journey by road, by ship and air. So the first image that you see right on top, the ribbon, is actually him sailing on the Black Sea. So they went by road, by ship, by air. This is the image. And it ended in Bidar, because that's where Nikitin came. And Shireen, who's with us today, was part of the last part of this trip, which ended in Hampi and Bidar. So this photograph is from there. And then I will take you just through the main sections. Okay, just go to the header page, Ma. Okay, so there's a biography. Okay, now let me say, this was the hardest to write. We wanted it to be a mix of a professional and a personal biography. So Ravi, his brother, and I put it together. There's a lot more to add. And there's only one thing out of the biography that I'd like to just dwell on here. Mrinalini mentioned. I think it was a matter of sheer accident that Hari landed up in Calcutta. There was nothing in his background that would have brought him here. He had no Calcutta connections. He had lived in Bangalore, Pune, and Delhi as a child when his father worked in the defense sciences. Then at the age of 9, his father went to Manchester, left the defense sciences, and became a defense engineer, aeronautical engineer, first in the University of Manchester. And then 2 years later, he joined the University of Nairobi. Very interesting time, 1960-61, Kenya's on the cusp of independence. So Hari's schooling was in all these little smaller schools. Then 1 year in Guruvayur. When his father had gone and his mother moved with the two boys to Guruvayur, waiting to join. And Hari says that 1 year in Guruvayur, and there's a photograph of him in a munda in Guruvayur. He said he unlearned all his convent education. He became a village boy. And he said the Malayalam he learned during that 1 year stayed with him for his remaining life. So Ravi Vasudevan does not have the Malayalam that Hari had. But Hari was also very, very good at languages. So that was the time. And then he grew up in Nairobi. We have some amazing photographs which his school friends from Nairobi have shared with him, of him as a prefect, all of that. And then he went to Cambridge, and at the age of 26, he decided he would return to India. Now, that is unusual, because what was dragging him back? He said it wasn't unusual because they had always been trained to believe that they would return to India. And he said, if I did not return then, I would never return, which was perhaps true. His father wanted him to sit the civil service exams, but I think Hari was too much of a scholar. So he first taught at Ramjas College, where Mushirul Hasan, his friend, was then the head of the department. And then he had an offer from St. Stephen's College, but Amulish Tripathi of Calcutta University also made him an offer. Those days, you could have job interviews on the phone, and he made him this offer. So people in Delhi thought he was a bit mad, leaving St. Stephen's College and coming to a provincial city. Hari always said that Calcutta was not a provincial city. He said, I came because, he always said, the National Library, Calcutta, had resources that were extraordinary. He said, I could not have found those resources anywhere else in India. And he said, postgraduate teaching. If at the age of 26, you get an entry into postgraduate teaching, and he was told he could teach European and Russian history. He said, that was it. He came once to see Calcutta. He said he saw Darbhanga building and fell in love with it. Brinaldi said, how could it happen? But he said, Stephens was like fake Oxford, Cambridge. I didn't want more of that, right? So he came. So that is how Hari, in December 78, arrived in Kolkata. It was 2 months after the great floods. The city was cleaner than he had ever seen it before. And he took a bus from Howrah station and arrived at Ashoka Gupta's house. Ashoka Mashi was the mother-in-law of Hari's cousin, Narayani Gupta, so they were close. Apparently, Ashoka Mashi told him, Esho Esho Anu, which is his dark name, Calcutta University, Rajon, Cambridge, take a lecture at Ashbe. Ami Tajunno Dariachi. So Hari said, but that's me. So that was it. And then he lived in a flat in Southern Avenue on Anando. And I think Hari never looked back. He thought he would return to Delhi. And he did go back to Delhi for shorter stints. But for various circumstances, he remained in the city. And he became one of the main Europeanists in the city, if I could say. Hari had this amazing array of languages when he already arrived: Latin, French, German, Russian, which he learned, and Malayalam, of course. In Delhi, he picked up Hindi. He knew Tamil because the family lived in Chennai. Bangla he learned, but he also resisted. My mother was determined to make a complete Bengali of him, and Hari resisted. Hari said, I know enough, but maybe somewhere I should stop. So somewhere he knew he was going to be colonized entirely. So that's where he held back. So the biography takes us through much of this, but also his time in Calcutta, when it was a remarkable time, I think the 80s still. It was the beginning of the time when a kind of different decline of the cultural and intellectual life of the city would begin. So we saw the best plays, we saw the best films in the city, we saw some fabulous exhibitions, including the great Rodas show. We never felt, by being in Calcutta, we were ever missing out on being in the world. So Calcutta, and he continued to believe that Calcutta had all the potentials of being a truly cosmopolitan global city. But we know that over his time, all of that ebbed. That would have made him sad, but Hari always knew how to move on to other things. So the biography takes us through some of this, his times elsewhere. Institutionally, the most productive part of his career was when he took over the directorship of Macias. And as we all know, he made the institution a happening place. And soon after he left, many other things took over. But his last institutional commitment was when he took over from Shubhashachi Bhattacharji as chairman of IDSK in 2019, but he did not even complete a year in the post, and it was a sudden going away. The memories of a Malabar lady will be published later this year. Ravi has completed it. Okay, now I will not take you through all his writings, but I like to say that some of Hari's books are here. One of the important books which is out of print is his book on the Russian archives, because after the breakup of the Soviet Union, he with a group of people went and explored the archives. What I've put together here, as I've said here, the number of books Hari wrote never matched really his erudition, and that everybody knows that Hari gave so much time institutionally into teaching that his books do not necessarily reflect what he really knew. He knew amazing. So putting together his writings, his academic writings, but equally, Hari during the 1990s became like a main political commentator on happenings in the Soviet Union, post-Soviet Union, Europe. So for Statesman and Telegraph, he wrote practically every 2 months. So there's much more in the Statesman to be got, but Telegraph, Shakti Babu was very, very generous. He just gave me all the writings that appeared then. So some of it we devote to his writings. And, okay, yeah. Now before, yeah, photos, we will go through, just go to photos, yeah. I will not take you through the photos, but the one which I'd like to show everybody is this one of Hari teaching in Calcutta University, because he had this style of teaching where he would write everything on the board, so that he became the most accessible teacher, because all the information was out there on the board. He would actually not use a PowerPoint, he would be writing everything. So this is just in 2018 that these are there. So his professional photograph albums, I won't take up too much time, they are in, and if we get more, we'll add them. So let's just run through them. Okay, so no, professional, just once more. Okay, so there are things like, this is from a trip to Ulanode in when he was director of Macias. This is from his time in Jamia. Rashmi Doraiswamy sent me photographs. This set is from his last trip to Moscow when he was part of the ICWA delegation. Okay, this is, the next one is a lecture he gave at Columbia University, which Gayatri D hosted. Next. Okay, this is, King Shuk will know, this is the trip to Myanmar that the Calcutta University delegation went on, and so on. So we have albums of his professional photographs, which we've captioned, and you can go through. The personal, you've already seen some. This is the Vasudevan family. Yeah, let's just do that so that you can quickly run. Now, you could see Hari was such a Nehruvian. At the age of 16, he's wearing a Nehru coat, standing there. He's 16 here. Okay, just quickly too. This is him in a convent in Pune. This is him in Guruvayur. And you know who Milanini looks like when you see that picture. This is him and his brother in Delhi, Christmas party. Favorite photograph. This we can skip, some of this. Okay, this, you know, Hari became like a son to our family. So this is at Gurushadai Road, a home some of you here may remember, with my brother Raja. This is with two of Raj Chandavarkar, one of his closest friends in Cambridge. This is from that time. Okay, so we'll not go through all of them. I'd like to show some of the holiday pictures that we went on. So, yeah. So, as a group, we decided to travel not to the West, but to Southeast Asia. That's a decision we took. So, our friend Ajanta accompanied us to two really remarkable, most remarkable trips, one to Angkor and one to Myanmar. And this is at Bagan. And it's from there that Hari's really interest in Myanmar. He then went off to Dagon, and we said, you've come on a holiday, what are you going to Dagon for? But he went off there. Okay, that's it. And there's only one more, the one with Veliamma, maybe we can show. Okay, now one of the abiding love in Hari's life was his aunt, Dr. M. Sharda Menon, who is going to be 98 this year. She's India's first women psychiatrist. And Veliamma was a second mother to Hari. And long before I met my in-laws, I met her, because my in-laws were still in Nairobi then. So Veliamma is shattered. So if there's somebody who's grieving even more for him, it's her. And this is him, Veliamma, Ravi. He would take his mother to Madras every year, including in 2019. It was a huge strain on him, but they would go. I'll end the personal photographs there. There are some videos, but I think I would rather move on. But just to show a short clip so that people can hear his voice. We will go to the, just go straight to the UGC lecture. Or go to the Belu lecture. Just go to the Belu lecture. Yeah. I'll just play one.
Well, firstly, let me thank the Maharaj as well as my friends in the Department of History for having invited me to speak to you on this occasion. Even though it's considered important that you should learn from me, I assure you that it is as important that I should learn from you, in the sense that most of the time, in such cases, whenever we deal with our subjects in history or in related areas, the conversation is with ourselves or with a very, very few people who are part of our set and who sometimes have time, sometimes don't have time. Hence, to give attention to this kind of subject for a substantial period of time is very rare to come by. On certain occasions, when you write about the subject...
One of the good things about this website is that we will hear Hari speaking again. We know in this virtual world, we can believe Hari is still there because much of our life is about people speaking to us on a screen, and Hari will continue to do that. This Belur College lecture began with a statement that I find is very, very quintessentially Hari. He said, "I've come here as much to tell you as to learn from you." And he was speaking to students on the centenary of the revolution. And then Hari said, in Bangla, je ami 15-20 minute Banglay bolte pari, kintu ami der ghonta lecture Banglay bolte parbo na. Kintu ami tumra jodi amake Banglay proshno koro, ami shegulor uttor debo. Kintu amar boktitata ingrejite hobe. And then he goes on to speak. But I thought just those few things showed the way in which he was able to reach out despite and speaking at these smaller colleges, being part of the College Service Commission, was as much part of his life as flying to Moscow or Columbia University. I think he was very rooted and he was very committed to the academic life of the state. So I'll leave it there. There are tributes and memorials also as part of the video, and there'll be more adding. We hope to add more writings. We hope to add more photographs. But with that, I think I've taken up more of my time. But Mrinalini will now introduce the speakers and we'll go on.
I'd like to call Monideepa, Toishi and Shantun to come. So as I said, the first part of this evening is really about folk music. Very brief introductions really for all of them. Monideepa is a music composer, lyricist and poet. And she has her own YouTube channel. You must check it out because she does a whole range of original compositions as well as, in fact, familiar folk tunes. Toishi is the vocalist. And Shayantun, in fact, has been, he's a sound engineer and keyboardist. And he's currently associated with Cactus. I didn't even know that they were back in the scene, but I look forward to listening to all the music.
Some songs that he used to like and also some which we like to perform for him. And another thing that I seriously want to mention right now is this performance of ours is not only dedicated to Hari Uncle. We lost another great person back in the year. He's Eddie Uncle. I miss him a lot. I wish I could get the time to say goodbye to both of them. So, Prathum Ganta Malita Kochi, this is a Kabir song. Thank you.
Thank you. বেগম আক্তারের একটা গান আছে, সো ফিরে যা কালো বন্ধু, মানে অনেকেই হয়তো আপনারা শুনেছেন। সো
Oh,
Thank you.
very dear it's a very dear song to me. That is Kobi Shumane, Shesh Hote Dilo.
It is actually funny.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, this song your loving spinning, swinging magnificent sun. It's already at any one. This is keeping on the run. And for the sky, there are no best spaces. And if you hear big traces of screaming, leaves or rhyme, no tambourine in time, I wouldn't pay it any mind. This is a ragged clown behind. You're seeing that he's chasing. Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, there's something in his GPM.
I should introduce Ranjan Pani. Ranjan Pani is a very well-known filmmaker. He's worked primarily in documentary film, but he made his first feature film.
Ranjan is also he's one of the very well-acclaimed cinematographers in India, and he graduated from the Film and Television Institute in India, and among various other very, very well and popular films that he's made is the one Saad Kurma, among others.
But I should also say his connection with Hari goes to the time Hari was director of Matthias.
No, I was there for your wedding.
Personal friendship, yeah. Oh, but professionally, when Hari was at Matthias, they had a special Northeast program. And Ranjan had made this fabulous film on Lou Major, the singer from Shillong, called Forever Young. So Hari commissioned from him a film called The Music of the Northeast, which has only been shown in Delhi and not in Kolkata. So maybe he do a screening.
He song after I think he kind of the blacks were waiting for all kinds of things. He was in jail for stabbing or doing something to his girlfriend. I think it was part. Anyway, he wrote this song and was pardoned. He got pardoned. It's called Good Night. I think I'll see you on my dreams.
I remember now. lives in town. Most times I had to wait. No wonder.
You got it yesterday.
Last verse. Stop rambling. Stop your rambling. Stop roaming the streets at night. Oh, you're right. You're alone. See by your fireside.
I think we are ready to get on with the Western music set. So Hasar, so just introducing Hasar, he is currently finishing a degree in philosophy from Jadavpur University, my old university. And he also has worked with the Neotia Arts Foundation. But most importantly, he's into music. He's a singer, in fact, and you're going to be listening to a nice set of songs today.
So before the program gets started on his set, he wanted me to read out something from it's a book called Tram, or The Art of Living a Wild and Poetic Life, Thomas Espedal. And this is really a section which is on travel and home. And of course, some days so much also to do daily with my father. So here goes. How good it is to get inside, to go through the door, put your feet on a floor, stand by the living room door and look in at the stove and the table, the windows and the doors, step through the living room, find the door to the bedroom. There is the bed. This is where I sleep. Feeling the joy a house gives isn't the same as the satisfaction of owning one. The pleasure goes deeper. It comes from finding a place to rest, a place that's warm and bright, where you can cook and eat in peace and quiet, a place where you can sit down at the window and look out. You're inside. The joy of a house is the joy of being within. The joy of being outside comes after you've found the house. It needn't be your own.
Edelweiss, every morning you greet me.
Nice
small and wide, clear.
To work on that list, we worked on it for a while. We decided to choose the songs which Uncle used to love, which he used to sing a lot, and which he used to enjoy listening to as well. So, since we are celebrating him today, what he's left behind, what the fact that he's still here, the fact that we're still talking about him, and that we'll keep on talking about him, I think I would really like it if all of us sing all of these songs, because these are songs which I think all of us know. So maybe if you could take out your phones for lyrics, I mean, even that is
good. Good
point. The lyrics, I think that's the point of this.
Knowing my musicality, Hari would say not you.
Hey, your generation, not ours. Manu and I
don't think it works like that. But that being said, I think we are all singing here together to remember something. We are all here, so please sing along.
Sure.
It's always a good feeling.
If I ever had to do the same, I Take my whole life to do. For I can to the sea. Darling, so it goes, 'cause some things are meant to be. So take my hand, take my whole life too, for I can't fall in love with you. For I can't help falling in love with you.
This is the song Auntie was talking about. The Catskill song called
Morning Star.
And since I heard you talk about it, I think I made a very special association in my own head as well, because when I heard the song for the first time, I interpreted it in a very different way, but that just changes the way I feel for this song since hearing it. So thank you.
Has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world. Sweet the rains new fall, suddenly from heaven. Like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet gardens. Spring in completeness where their feet pass. Spoken like the first word. for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for the springing, fresh from the world.
Words that I'm the sound of silence.
Exactly.
Be afraid.
Things together, made things flow so beautifully. So, yeah.